I play here is called dun dun. Everyone say dun dun. D-U-N-D-U-N. Dun dun. It's carved out of solid tree trunk and it's hollowed out. Without warp or skin, you'll be able to see through it. It's just gonna look like a tube. So dun dun is carved by blacksmiths and it's got a cow hide at both ends. Dun dun have a two note. The first one is just let the stick bounce, and we call that one open. If you mute the first note, it's the second note we call close. So it goes like this. That's dun dun. All right, dun dun have a cow high. That's why I'm able to play with the stick. And dun dun, cow skin can take so much. So I have three of them. Each one is like the. That one we call this one kankini. The middle one we call that one sangba. The big one we call it dun dun. So it's both they call dun dun. All right, so I have three of them. I have three. Six note each. Right. So my job is to play a steady beat. To give you a steady beat. When you're dancing, you listen to me. Right. So that's dun dun.
So when you guys get your dun dun, of which we've got about 10 extra ones we brought for you before the end of the show, make sure you're careful with the sticks. Sometimes if you get too excited, that's where trouble can happen with the sticks on the dun dun. Anyone have a question, or are you guys ready for a little music?
Ready.
You got a quick one, or you ready? Yes, man, I like that. actually not Jacob Edwards, but a different Jacob named, what's his last name? Kone, right? Yeah, so Jacob Kone, he carves the drum shells like this, then he sends them to City or to Issa. We go to Boston and pick them up just like this, and we do all the rest of our work right here in America. Like, we'll take rebar, that's what is on here, and we'll bend it around in a circle and weld it as a way to hold the skin, and then we use the mountain climbing rope, and a lot of times recycled goat skin, because goat skin was the original one after antelope. In the beginning it started as antelope, later when people were eating a lot of goat, you had a lot of extra goat skin. So we used them, but on this one I'm playing, which is City's drum, he put a cow skin on it, because he's part of Berklee School of Music, he's playing all over the world like 10 times a week. So if he puts a goat skin on it, it's gonna break maybe every 2, 3, 4 weeks, finished. The goat skin's so thin, he puts a nice thick cow skin on it, and it'll last, I don't know, can it last a year or not quite?
Yeah, sometimes. Yeah.
It could last a year for you?
With the cow, yeah.
With the cow skin, yeah. The only problem I'll tell you is cow skin is a lot harder on your hands, so if you try this one tonight, be careful, you can feel it for sure. So this one, by the way, is called djembe. Everyone say djembe.
Djembe.
Now Sidi, in Mali, where does djembe come from? What does that mean and stuff like that? Can you share a little bit of the culture with them so they have an understanding of what they're listening to?
Great, so djembe is basically what's happening right now. Like, you know, whenever we play the djembe, that means we should all gather and celebrate life. And most for the most part, djembe is only played for the good stuff, like when there's fun stuff like a wedding, a new baby born, and new library birth, something like that. So we play the djembe. So the name tells itself, so the story, you know. So in Mali, back in the day, even still now, we still do those traditions. When something is happening in the town or the city, you play the djembe to let everybody know what's happening. And by the song you are playing, everybody know what it is. So, and they come, you know, you don't need to be invited by mail or something. You hear the djembe, you show up, you know. And we, as a culture and a history, we don't do head count. So when you hear the djembe show up, you will have a food for you. So because you always make enough for everybody. Like knowing, you know, we have experience about the neighborhood who's gonna be. So that's the main thing with the djembe. So the name describes itself. And djembe, as you can see, was born in the Mande Empire, which was the biggest empire in West Africa before the French came and split it up. Because when French came over, they colonized Mande, then later they split countries, you know, make some teeny tiny, make some bigger than South. So now we have now we have Mali, Guinea, Ivory Coast, Burkina Faso, many, many countries now, you know, in the same thing. So djembe was born there, so it was one bigger empire, so. But now, if you pay attention, like, those countries, we still share the same background, like ethnic group, same food, same tradition and stuff, right? So djembe is big thing in our culture, and I'm happy to be playing in the US and everywhere else, you know? And I hope you guys are enjoying it. Yes.
Anyone here ever tried djembe before?
A few.
Okay, after tonight it should be everybody if things go right. So we'd do a little bit more music for you, maybe Idrissa, if you feel it, you could show them how a move would look. If we're playing good enough that it makes your feet move, don't hesitate. Then they can see how it fits with the dance a little bit. We can talk about your instrument after and then get everybody doing some music.
Thank you.
And I want everybody to say it loud. Tamani.
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 Tamani in English, talking drum.
Talking.
You're right.
Yeah.
Back in the day in our society, we used this little drum to do our communication. That's why we call this little Chinese drum talking drum. For example, if some events going on, like today, you don't have to just go and SMS, send email to everybody, hey, we have this thing going on today in this town. So that was the talking drum job. They tell the talking drum player, and he's gonna take his talking drum, keep working, block to block, town to town, and when he start play a talking drum, and people in the village gonna pay attention, and start telling them, this is happening that day, here and here. So we communicated before in this little drum. Tamani.
Tamani.
Thank you.
So it's almost like the European version of an old town crier or something where they play the trumpets. Hey, there's going to be a wedding on Sunday. Something special is happening. That's their style of it. But to me, honestly, these drums are amazing. Dun dun is my favorite. Djembe sounds so exciting and it's fun to play. But that one is a scientific wonderment. I mean, can I see it for 1 second, Idrissa?
Sure.
I won't break it, probably. But you know, sometimes if you look at it, you might not know what you see. Like you see all this rope, but if you peer between the rope, can you see the wood in there?
Yeah.
Do you know how it has a certain shape? It is the kind of shape they call in English like an hourglass shape. Like you could fill it with sand and then turn it over and measure time. Because it's got that hourglass shape and all this rope lacing each skin together, there's room. It's almost the same like a dundun, except the wood is so skinny in the middle. On a dundun, you can't squeeze it to do anything, you just hit it. But on this one, depending how hard you squeeze, each time you're tightening it, it's getting a little bit higher pitch. The skin's getting a little bit more tight, so it's like a percussion trombone. If you don't squeeze it, it's low. And then as you start squeezing it, you can get every single note. A lot of times when we play a concert with the entire melody instruments playing together, Idrissa will solo with the guitar player or solo with the chord player, and he'll hit the notes of the song, not just some kind of rhythmic thing, but you know, A sharp and F minor and all this stuff. We can do it right on the talking drum. So a lot of times people didn't get a chance to see how that goes. Can you show us how it really works?
So